Greetings and welcome, Bethlehem Lutheran Church, on this third Sunday after Epiphany. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious God, have mercy on us. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown. Things done and left undone. Uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. To the honor and glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you unto eternal life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
To follow you, it is the cry of my heart to follow you. came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, the great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. Word of God, word of life. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. Word of God, word of life.
Silence, for my hope is from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my deliverance and my honor, my mighty rock. My refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. State are a delusion. In the balances, they go up. They are together lighter than a breath. Put no confidence in extortion and set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God. And steadfast love belongs to you, O Lord. For you repay to all according to their work.
According to St. Mark, beginning in the first chapter, glory to you, O Lord. Now after John the Baptist, was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the gospel, the good news of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, follow me and I will make you fish for people. And immediately they left their nets and they followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men, and they followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The time is fulfilled. That's the phrase that leapt out at me this week, though the idea of fishing for people is the far more familiar one from this gospel lesson, and we'll get there, I promise. But first, the time is fulfilled. It's a phrase that raises rich questions. It's kind of like our word commencement, where we mark the occasion of a new beginning by recognizing the ending of an old one. Catholic evangelist Bishop Robert Barron was once asked a great question that really touches on the ambiguity in this phrase, the time is fulfilled. His interlocutor asked, if Jesus already did what he came to do, assume a body, enter death to destroy it, restore humanity to grace, and Satan realized he was beat, why wasn't that the end of the story? What are we still doing here? Love that question. And I love the good bishop's answer. He said that we are living through Act 5 of a theodrama. Not the ego drama, right? My story, but God's, the theodrama. And Act 5 is the age of the church, an idea that Bishop Barron borrows from an Anglican bishop, N.T. Wright. Here's how Bishop Barron explains the relationship between Christ's finished work and the age of the church. He said, Jesus, with his dying and rising, represents D-Day. It's the victory of the Allies on the beaches of Normandy in June of 1944. So in less than a year, Germany would be defeated, and anyone who was politically or militarily plugged in knew already on June the 7th, 1944, that the war was over, that we had already won, that the enemy had been defeated, even though there was a tough slog ahead, including the famous Battle of the Bulge, which was one of the most deadly battles of the war, which would take place that winter of 1944. So Bishop Barron continues, the dying and rising of Jesus is the great victory, the definitive victory. The war is in principle over. I love that insight, that the age of the church is this mop-up operation. Now, maybe that conceit works for you, or maybe the martial imagery makes us a little uncomfortable. But if we look closely, it's right there in our gospel lesson for today. My Lutheran colleague and dear friend, Pastor Stout, pointed out just this in his sermon for this week, that Jesus doesn't just pluck this fishing metaphor out of thin air, but rather he draws on a well-recognized biblical trope. Here's how Pastor Stout put it. Jesus is drawing on this long prophetic tradition of the Bible in which fishing for people is an established image of violence, judgment, death, and resurrection. Pastor Stout continues, fishing is an aggressive, bloody business. We may not think so, relaxing in our boats, but on the Sea of Galilee, Peter and Andrew, James and John are flinging out their nets and dragging them through the water and drawing up their catch. And And then the fish are sorted, gutted, cleaned, and killed, cooked, dried, and eaten. The fish die so that the fishermen and their families may live. I remind us of this obvious fact only because after years of hearing this story, we can forget how unsettling and aggressive this image is. That the result of being caught in our Lord's net is, in fact, death. This is the startling idea that motivated Dietrich Bonhoeffer to pen those familiar words: when Christ calls a person, he bids him come and die. Commenting on our gospel lesson today, Lutheran pastor and professor of Hebrew, Chad Bird, says this: the image of fishing for men in the Old Testament is a very violent image. It involves catching people so they can face the Lord, whatever that might entail in the Old Testament. If you are the fish, if someone is fishing for you, it basically means that when they catch you, life as you know it is now over. See, when Christ catches us up in the net of his grace, it is so that we might die to self and live to him. The end of one thing and the beginning of something new. Now, this fishing image is dramatic, and we love stories of dramatic conversions. Scrooge reformed, the prodigal son returned, the sinner repentant. But in our lives, so often, conversion, the putting to death of the old sinner, is a messy process. Back and forth, two steps forward and one step back. In holy baptism, justified by faith, Christ's work is finished in one sense, and yet in another sense, it is only just begun. Our soul belongs to the great captain himself. The war is surely won, but the storms still rage, the battles rage on. So in the life of sanctification, we experience this great struggle. And as we confess our sins and hear again our Lord's forgiveness, Christ is once again catching us in his net and hauling us out of the water. Remember in the Old Testament that the sea was always an image of primal chaos, the nothingness, the non-being, the formless void, the uncreated mess. That's what swimming in pride or selfishness or greed looks like. And the truth is, there is something in us, that old sinner, that is constantly being drawn back to those waters of chaos, as if we're hearing that siren song and being tempted to jump over the side and swim out. For fish accustomed to these murky depths, sanctification is a messy process. Sometimes we cooperate with our ongoing conversion, but sometimes the sea is too much in us. And so, like fish flopping on the deck, the air gone out of our gills, we resist the work of the Spirit, and we are tempted, or we do in fact abandon ship. In the symbolism of the New Testament writers, the church is a ship, the new ark on which we sail through the chaos and the storms. And sometimes that ship feels like a luxury cruise liner, but sometimes it feels like a waterlogged piece of driftwood. We act out of fear. We lash out in anger. We tear one another down. We judge and gossip and complain. We misuse the good gifts that God has given us. When that's our experience, no wonder so many abandon ship. Mixing our metaphors here in good biblical fashion, we must always remember that the church is, first of all, not people, but a body, the body of Christ, a body that bears the scars of our every harsh word, our every act of unkindness. Christ's body is battered and beaten, to be sure. But apart from that body, there is no salvation. And so we are saved as through water. In holy baptism, when the old sinner in us is drowned and we are dragged aboard this boat. And yes, we flip and we flop and we fall flat on our faces because the victory is ours, Christ's triumph is assured, but those skirmishes with sin, death, and the devil, our battles of the bulge, as it were, persist. One of my dear friends describes himself as an alcoholic. In a former life, he was also addicted to drugs, and by God's grace, he sought help. He went to treatment. He was diligent in attending AA meetings. He cooperated with a kind of conversion, and in fact, through that process, really came back to a stronger faith, and to this day, is a far more faithful pastor than I will ever be. Thanks be to God, as he looks back over his life, he can say that he has been sober for over a decade. But that doesn't mean that the struggle doesn't continue for him, that he no longer feels that pull toward the watery chaos, what the Apostle Paul describes as a violent struggle, the flesh warring against the spirit. St. Paul admonishes the church in his letter to the Galatians, live by the Spirit. Do not gratify the desires of the flesh, but it was for freedom that Christ has set you free. So stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. See, there are days when we think we might actually prefer the chaos of fear, the routine of addiction, the numbing that comes from our narcotic of choice, whether it's binging Netflix or being tempted toward the nothingness of oblivion. St. Paul says that to be caught by Christ's grace, though, is true freedom. Christ has liberated us from those watery depths, so don't go back. Don't submit yourself to that yoke of slavery. To use C.S. Lewis's language, God's salvation is a severe mercy. It's a mercy as severe as death, and it's a death as merciful as love. How easy it would be for the Lord to let us just slip off the boat, to sink back down into the chaos of sin and death. But instead, he keeps casting his net. He keeps drawing us back and hauling us in by the Spirit. He keeps submitting us to the kind of dying that actually is a fuller kind of living. The death of one thing and the birth of something new. And in truth, we pass through seasons where the dying to self is harder. To use another biblical metaphor, we are no sooner liberated from that yoke of slavery than we are complaining about the desert heat and longing for the flesh pots of Egypt. But Christ knows our needs better than we do ourselves. And by his grace, his severe but tender mercy, we're transformed. We're caught in the net of his word and sacrament. We are made more than just fish, but we are united to the fisherman. We don't save, that's Christ's work, the work of the Spirit, but as our gospel lesson makes clear, the dignity of our work is that we get to cooperate with Christ in his. And global pandemic may have changed a lot of things, but it doesn't change our Lord's command to baptize and to disciple the nations, to preach the gospel. We have a number of references in Mark this morning to that word gospel, which is translated good news in the NRSV. But that word gospel has a particular Old Testament context that I want to remind us of this morning. It refers to news of a military victory. A gospeler is one who runs ahead of the king's army to announce the good news that the battle is won, the enemy is defeated, the oppressor's rod broken, and the captives liberated. Sisters and brothers in Christ, our mission is to announce that victory. Our mission is to proclaim that good news of Christ's redemptive death and salvific rising, of his unending love and his unflagging forgiveness. Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers of darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness. But our God is a mighty fortress. And in the words of that famous hymn, God's word forever shall abide, no thanks to foes who fear it. For God himself fights by our side with weapons of the Spirit. Hear those words, Bethlehem, and do not be discouraged. Do not lose heart, for the time is fulfilled. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Christ, we find a path.
Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all in need. For the church throughout the world, for pastors and teachers, for deacons and deaconesses, for musicians and servers, that all might proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, we respond, hear our prayer. For skies and seas, for birds and fish, for favorable weather and clean water, for the well-being of your creation, that God would raise up advocates and scientists to guide our care for all the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who provide leadership in our cities and around the world, for nonprofit and non-governmental organizations, for planning commissions and homeless advocates, that they would be inspired in the just use of their wealth and their resources. For President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris, that they would govern justly and listen to the wise counsel of those who work for the flourishing of all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who are sick, distressed, or grieving, for the outcast and all who await relief, that in the midst of suffering, your peace and mercy would surround them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our congregation and community, for families big and small, for students struggling with distance learning, for our school here, our teachers, our administrators and staff, our students and their families. Provide for their needs, we pray. For quiet times, for Bible studies, for prayer groups, that God's steadfast love might serve as a model for all relationships, and that through those gatherings, the gospel would be shared and believed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In thanksgiving for our forebears in the faith whose lives serve as an example of gospel living, and in hope that our lives might also witness to the truth and point others to salvation through Christ, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Greetings and welcome, Bethlehem Lutheran Church, to this service on the first, second, third Sunday of Advent.
That's right.
Her reaction would have been good, though.
Insane in the membrane.
Don't fight it, embrace it.
Insane in the brain.
Now we are on.
Okay, cool.